Welcome to our performance of the American Revolution. A reminder, our students have worked really hard to put this together for you, so it's important that the lines can be heard. More than any other musical that the school puts on, the lines are really important. It tells a story. There are puns. Feel free to laugh if you get the jokes. If you don't, your kids will laugh at you later. So either way, the laughing will happen. They have choreographed.
People, if you move into the middle, unfortunately, the way this is...
The microphones hang right here. So if you're at that end, you're not going to see somebody standing here. The same is true
move over here.
It works really well when they're little, but as they get bigger, they take our spot. So if you have a little one with you that just can't stay quiet, feel free to wander on out with them. It is actually less distracting having you get up and walk with them than to have them stay. So thank you and enjoy the show.
If you're like me, you're tired of the same old stories about the American Revolution.
Enough about George already. We want to hear about someone else like
Betsy Ross.
Betsy Ross.
Finally, the woman who sewed the first American flag tells all about the stitch heard around the world.
And now everybody, here she is, the seamstress of the revolution,
the empress of embroidery,
the sultan of saddle stitch,
the guru of needlework,
Betsy Ross.
Here in America in 1763.
Yes, but the French in the New World
7.
That's quite important, isn't it?
Yes, my lord. Our victory is especially beneficial for our prospects in America.
America? How splendid! Did we get any of those fur hats? You can't beat America for fur hats.
Even better, your majesty.
Better than fur hats? You don't mean fur sunglasses?
Your majesty, we've driven the French out of most of America. The entire north is ours, as well as Florida and everything east of the Mississippi.
Our empire has never been bigger. We rule the seas. Our colonies are rich and well-organized. England is the most powerful country in the world.
In other words?
That's right, your majesty.
You the man. Who the man?
You the man.
Who the man?
You the man.
Who the man? Do it right on the man.
We sank those saints, we fought the French, we whipped the world, yeah, we're a mensch. Our colonies are our great joy. Hey, America, our favorite toy. And it's great to be an empire. Everyone shines your shoes.
Well, of course, but the good ones rhyme. and take Ben Franklin's maxims. He that goes a borrowing goes a sorrowing. Little strokes spell great oaks. How deep while so good sleep.
Okay, I get it. The point is, the British aren't treating us as equals but as subjects. They've prohibited us from settling beyond the Appalachians. They've even started enforcing the navigation laws, so all commerce between England and Europe is by British vessels.
You're right, this has got to stop.
In the George must have been mad.
Oh, the English were really getting their threads in a tangle. They closed Boston Harbor, put restrictions on town meetings, and trials for officials who killed Honest were moved to England.
Betsy Ross, I'm so glad you're home.
John Day, you look like you're about to bust the stitch.
I've been trying to knit a sweater for my poodle, but something's gone terrible.
Hold on, let me take a look at that. So Betsy, what did we do after the British shut Boston Harbor?
Why, we held the first Continental Congress.
Were you there, Mr. Day?
Sure was. 55 men gathered, including John and Sam Adams, George Washington, and Patrick Henry.
I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death.
Wow, is that Patrick Henry? Don't encourage him, or he'll just be Did all colonists want independence?
Well, at that point, most of us just wanted the legislation repealed. We called for complete boycott of all British goods, but when our petitions were rejected, we began to collect muskets.
And that's when the British decided to send troops from Boston to seize weapons and arrest colonial leaders, right?
And thus the famous ride of Paul Revere.
Paul Revere? Sweet boy, I think I would start a horse for him.
The redcoats are coming! The redcoats are coming!
Calm down, Paul. It's nearly midnight. The wait for the kids.
We're awake! The redcoats are coming!
Sit down, children. Your father's a bit nervous.
Of course I'm nervous. The British are heading out of Boston, coming to arrest our colonial leaders, take our weapons and supplies.
Are they coming by land or by sea?
I don't remember. I think it's two if by land and one if by sea. Or maybe it's one if by land and two if by sea. I think three means they're coming by blimp.
Take it easy. You have to go on to the Gulf as Lieutenant Conker.
Yes, I must go at once.
Fade.
July 4, 1776, the Second Continental Congress is now in session in Independence Hall, Philadelphia. The Honorable John Hancock presiding.
Tom Jefferson. Where's John Hancock?
Oh, hello, Ben. Well, I sent him out to go get some hockey cake.
Hockey cake?
Of course. What's a Continental Congress without a Continental breakfast?
I heartily agree, Tom. But we already have a selection of coffee, juices, and those delicious individually wrapped danishes.
True. But I thought John needed something to do this morning. He's been acting a bit strange since we voted to endorse the Declaration of Independence.
A brilliant document, Tom. And now we must all hang together, or surely we shall all hang separately.
It's been over a year since the first shots have been fired between us and the British. Just a month later, we elected George Washington to head the Continental Army. We've been unofficially at war ever since.
King George has rejected our efforts at reconciliation.
Tom Paine put it nicely when he wrote, "These are the times that try men's souls."
Yes, that was well put. It doesn't rhyme, though, does it?
What?
I think my own maxims always did a bit better with a cute rhyme. Vessels large may venture more, but little boats should keep near shore. See how it flows?
Sure, Ben, but I don't think...
Or remember this. Here Scott lies snug as a bug in the rug.
What exactly does that mean?
That's not the point. I've got 4 rhyming words, they're out of 10. That's a 40% rhyme rate. You won't find that in any of the British poets. Check out Shakespeare or Pope. They got 10, maybe 15% rhyme rate, max.
That's great, Ben.
Great, it's crucial. The British may have better trained soldiers, they may have more money, experience and weapons, but America has rhymes. Victory will be ours.
Uh-oh, here comes John Hancock.
Where is it?
What are you looking for?
The Declaration of Independence.
It's quite exciting, isn't it?
You bet. Where is it?
Here in Tom's head. He wrote it. Tom, recite that bit about the self-evident truths again.
We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Yeah, that's great, but where is it? Where's the parchment itself? I'm ready.
Ready for what?
Ready to sign it, of course.
John, I told you this morning, the final document will be ready for a month or so.
But I'm ready now, I've been practicing.
You should.
way, there was no real unity. The colonists distrusted each other.
And there was no central authority to raise money through taxes.
The army was hard to organize and nearly impossible to keep together.
And don't forget, probably no more than one-third of the colonists even wanted independence all that much.
And there were hundreds of thousands who remained loyal to England.
True, but the British soldiers were 3,000 miles away from home and had a huge area to try to control.
And they had second-rate generals.
While the colonists had George Washington, who turned out to be a fantastic leader.
And don't forget the French. They always ready to help anyone who might hurt England.
But you're forgetting one of the biggest advantages.
I was wondering when you remember.
What?
My flag, of course. I tried to talk them into a red, white, and blue lounge chair with matching ornaments, but they said their budget was limited to a flag.
Oh, your flag was wonderful, but I was thinking about how the colonists fought dirty. I didn't mean it that way. I mean they were literally dirty. They blended in with the scenery.
I tell you, it ain't right. They should stand up and fight like we do.
Yeah, instead of sneaking around with those fur caps and deerskin coats all high like, we can't even see them. It ain't fair.
I mean, look at us, all polished up, bright and red. They can see us coming miles away. That's the proper way to fight.
Exactly. We stand up straight and wait our turn to shoot and be shot at. It's gentlemanly, not the skulking around.
Well, I'm on tour. You won't find one of them men sneaking up on me. No, sir.
Defeat.
Get it?
What's
that lovely item over there, Alice?
This is B-60.
1775. It's no longer valid for us because of reason where George Washington and his army were forced to spend a devastating winter.
They're going fast, folks.
We sold out in just 15 minutes last time we offered these at this unbelievable training price.
Just one per customer, please.
We just took a few minutes before our shop completely melted under these studio lights.
And we've got a satisfied customer. Hi there, who are you? Tell us where you're calling from. Tell us just how much you love your snow.
Hello, I'm in the air.
You sure are.
I'm coming to from Ball, from France.
How wonderful! General Roosevelt arrived in France in 1780 with over 6,000 troops to aid the colonists. Great chocolate was decisive in the end of the war.
Rochambeau, you say? Didn't you invent chocolate eclairs?
No! I was commander of the French troops in Yorktown along with George Washington and his men. Thought you were familiar.
So tell us. Terrific, so tell us. How do you like your snowball? You must serve it with some fancy French sauce. Am I right?
I have no idea what you're talking about. I'm a commander, not a chef.
Those French cooks. So modest.
Our next incredible item is being purchased right now by Jean-Paul Jones.
Hi, Alice. I just helped the American Navy get its sea legs and even defeated a number of British ships off the coast of England.
So what's that item you got there?
This is a button from Coke British General Cornwallis when he surrendered to George Washington along with some French allies at Yorktown in 1781. It's a lovely brass finish and oven safe.
Amazing! Put it up, sir. Here's to them. Good luck at it.
Benedict Arnold, give that back, you traitor. I have not yet begun to fight.
Well, I guess that will do it for us, too.
Good night. And stay tuned. Next on the American History Channel, we have our new documentary of Louis Cleveland, Man, Myth, City, or Sesame Street Puppet.
Just going round this way. Washington presiding.
Good afternoon, Mr. Madison.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Mr. Hamilton.
Oh, yes, good afternoon. James, we have some important decisions to make.
Yes, we do, Alexander.
Look, it's Aaron Burr!
I was just joking. I love doing that.
That wasn't funny.
Oh, lighten up a little, Alexander. We've already made great progress. We've already agreed on having three branches of government. The executive, legislative, and judicial, which will balance and check each other.
Oh yes, a wonderful plan. But there's even more important matters. I need your advice.
What's on your mind, Alexander?
You know I favor a strong central bank, and I'm faced with a huge decision.
What is it?
Which do you think is more impressive, my left profile or my right?
What?
When we start printing money, I'm just dying to get my picture on one of the bills. George Washington's already playing the one, so I'm shooting for the 10. Personally, I think my left side makes me look taller. What do you think?
Not exactly what I meant by Alexander. We have some real issues to discuss here. Look, the big states and small states still can't agree on how they should be represented in Congress.
We big states are more people. We're not going to share equally with big small states.
Oh, yeah?
Oh no. Some people fight against central government too much power.
Others thought states had too much authority. I wrote some of the Federalist Papers to help convince people to vote for it.
Did it work?
Well, it took a while. We had to promise the Bill of Rights would be added. The Constitution was officially adopted June 21st, 1788.
Wow, that first election must have been something.
It was. Members of the House of Representatives were elected directly by the citizens of each state. The senators were elected by the legislators of each state. And George Washington was unanimously elected as president by the Electoral College.
How does that work?
No one knows, dear. It's a complete mystery.
Please, Betsy, it's just a bit complicated.
Well, why don't we let these folks here explain it, since they're on their way to participate in the first Electoral College?
So, how exactly does this work?
Don't know.
Well, look in the Constitution, read the first sentence.
We the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and ensure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America.
I said just the first sentence.
That was just the first sentence.
Wow, find a part about the Electoral College.
Here it is in Article 2. The electors shall meet in their respective states and vote by ballot for two persons, of whom one at least shall not be an inhabitant of the same state as themselves.
Not an inhabitant of the same state as themselves? How does that work?
Don't know, but maybe this will help. But in choosing the president, the vote shall be taken by states. The representation from each state has one vote. A quorum for this purpose shall consist of a member or members from two-thirds of the states, and a majority of all states shall be necessary to the choice.
What does that mean?
Don't know, but what the heck? We get a vote.
Was elected as President of the United States in the temporary capital of New York.
Wow, what a great story.
As my friend Ben Franklin said at the time, our Constitution is an actual operation. Everything appears to promise that it will last, but in this world, nothing is certain but death and taxes.
I have Franklin's stove now. Doesn't look a bit like it. Ah, here you go, John. This should work.
Thanks, Betsy. It's perfect. I knew you could fix it. I've got to show off my head.
The French general who fought for the colonists?
No, a poodle. Betsy, can you tell us the story again?
We just finished, my dears.
Please?
Well, John Goodman. But he did leave out some of the more important parts, like when I wove a ship for the Navy out of nothing but pine needles, or how I sewed together the pants of the British Army so they couldn't run up Bunker Hill.
Without Kim Orzell, who's hiding in the back, our wonderful music teacher. And thank you to all of you, because I know you've worked with your students on Lines at Home. You've also heard these songs being sung quite a bit in the last month or so. So thank you to you for your support of arts and performing arts at Earhart School. It means a lot to have you be our partners. And let's give our actors one more round of applause.